want to thank, on behalf of NEED, Temple Sinai very much, the staff and Rabbi Meckelberg, who have provided great support to us, a wonderful space, as you can see, refreshments that are at the back, and they've set up the audiovisual for us. We love coming to Temple Sinai, and we thank them very much, because we always get a great warm welcome. We have to say a very special thank you to the generosity of Lawn and Barbara Bernstein, and we're so happy to have Lawn here with us tonight, and their Kedushat HaGuf Fund for making the symposiums possible. It is through their generosity that we have been able to hold right now our fifth symposium at Temple Sinai. So thank you very much. And in fact, this is our 59th symposium, which is also wonderful for NEED, so be on the lookout for our 60th. The Bernsteins are true examples of what giving back to the community is, and they believe that success starts with building awareness and education, which is the same as NEED. We hope by giving these symposiums that we can build awareness and help you and give you support and understanding in your own situations. Before we begin, I would like to call on Lawn. We're very lucky to have you here tonight to say a few words. Lawn?
I'm not sure how lucky. Thank you, Marvin. Just a few brief words. Everybody in this room understands and knows that disordered eating shows itself in a variety of forms, whether it's bulimia or anorexia or any of the myriad of other tags that are given to it. The one thing we also know is that it affects, it doesn't play favorites. It certainly doesn't play favorites across the population. We know they're predominantly is affecting the female population, but it certainly doesn't exclude the male population. We also know, truly know, that it knows no religion. It cuts across the entire population. And when Barbara and I decided that we needed to place our money where our mouth was. For us it was more about where is a safe environment. We talk about eating disorders in a variety of forms, and we know that that our children, our loved ones, our relatives, or whoever it is that we're concerned about, will tell you in an honest moment that very often it's shame-based. And it is kind of ironic that, well, in itself it's shame-based for the sufferer, that individual. It affects the family in the same way. And we just felt that there should be no safer place than, in this case, a synagogue, to hold a symposium or to hold seminars or to introduce programs in which people can gather, congregate, and feel comfortable talking about the subject. It happens to be tonight in the synagogue, and I would like to think that it holds true across the churches and the mosques and everything else. I just believe that religious institutions have an important place in the education that we hope to put forward, and even if it's nothing more than providing a safe environment in which to discuss the issues that we and the challenges that we have in front of us. So thank you for being here tonight, and please keep coming out wherever the symposiums are held, and certainly we look forward to many more of them at Temple Sinai. Let's have a wonderful evening together and a productive evening together.
Thank you. Hi everyone and welcome. For those of you who don't know who I am, I'm Wendy Crespo, the founder of NEED. NEED has been alive and thriving for the past 5.5 years. I'm so blessed and grateful to have an amazing and dedicated steering committee and exceptional volunteers. We are all volunteers, working daily and passionately to help you all to change the significant gaps and extremely apparent lack-offs in Canada. A special thank you to our colleagues and friends from NEDIC who have generously offered to live stream our symposium. Previously, our theme has always been go big or go home. This year, though, it changed to go bigger or go home. And I must tell you all that go bigger is where we are. Let me relay our bigger force. The Canadian Mental Health Association, the CMHA, who has 88 chapters across the country, acknowledged they did not include eating disorders as a mental illness and have reached out to collaborate with NEDIC and NEED for Eating Disorders Awareness Week in February 2018. This is huge, that an organization of this magnitude reached out to us. Number two, September 2016, almost a year ago exactly, in Winnipeg, NEED initiated a meeting of stakeholders from across the country, and as a result, four national organizations, NEDIC, NEED, and two others, are currently working on a national eating disorder strategy for Canada. Again, never been done before. Number three, NEED has also been accepted as a member of the National Collaborative for Suicide Prevention with the Mental Health Commission of Canada. Finally, eating disorders are at this table too, as the second cause of death for those with eating disorders is unfortunately suicide. Number four, NEED is also now a member of the Enriches Collaborative of local health and community leaders who address the complex challenges facing caregivers. How many of us, me included, feel isolated and exhausted as caregivers looking after adults with eating disorders? I am in awe of what we have accomplished in these years, the overwhelming support of frontline clinicians, researchers, and eating disorder experts in Ontario and across the country has truly demonstrated the chronic and dire need facing eating disorder individuals and families in Canada. I started NEED because our daughter Amy, who is now 32, has been suffering with anorexia and bulimia for over 17 years, over half of her life. Our experiences of helplessness, frustration, and ultimately anger fueled me to want to create awareness and take action regarding the bizarre and unforgiving world of eating disorders. I could not sit back knowing there were close to 1 million families just like ours, struggling every minute of every day for years and years, often with no end in sight. As parents and caregivers to a young adult, we have done everything possible, 24/7, physically and financially, to provide and help our daughter. The daily emotional drain and strain on us is unimaginable. The stress on families is extreme, horrendous, and devastating. The pain for individuals who have an eating disorder is insurmountable. As parents, we live with fear, stress, heartache, broken relationships, broken hearts, attempted suicides, shoplifting, worry, panic, helplessness, and every so often, a teeny bit of hope. We have been through every negative and positive emotion possible. We never, ever have peace of mind, not for 1 minute. I would like to conclude by reading a poem Amy wrote in response to an article describing eating disorders as a passion. My eating disorder is not. It's not a diet, nor a lifestyle, or a senseless teenage phase. It's not stupid, it's not silly, nor the latest weight loss craze. It's not a passion, not a hobby, and it is not some twisted game. It's fatal, yes, it's deadly, it's an illness of the brain. It's not fun, and it's not funny, not intentional, not a choice. It kills you slowly every day and overtakes your voice. It's not my fault, it's not intentional, not some spiteful sleight of hand. It's an anxiety-driven, fear-based disease that too few understand. It's not a joke, and it's not selfish, it is the furthest thing from vain. It's a drastic telltale of no self-esteem and unparalleled burning shame. It's not malicious, nor dismissive, not distinct to middle-class white girls. It's a disease like any other, ensnaring every age, class, and race around the world. It's not uncommon, it's not weird, it dates back centuries, nothing new. It's the single most fatal mental illness, which all statistics prove to be true. Telling an anorexic to just eat is like expecting a deaf person to just talk. Telling a binge eater to just stop is like demanding a paraplegic to just walk. Telling a bulimic to just eat normally is cruel, ignorant, and frustrating. Telling an exercise addict to just sit down is like telling schizophrenics to just stop hallucinating. This illness is biological and genetic. It's like cancer of mind and thought. It doesn't come from nowhere. You are either born susceptible or not. If you think this is a ridiculous phase, or that we'd be fine if we just tried, then explain to me the shocking rate of sufferers committing suicide. If eating disorders were just a stupid choice, or you think that we're just lying, then why are millions desperate for help while millions more are dying?
My name is Lynn Koss, and I'm a co-founder of Need and on the steering committee. And it is my pleasure this evening to introduce Amy, who is going to be our speaker. I'd like to take a moment to introduce this wonderful, knowledgeable woman who is working so hard at helping us learn more about eating disorders. Amy is a fifth-year PhD candidate in neuroscience at the Faculty of Medicine, University of Toronto. She grew up in Washington, D.C. and holds dual bachelor's degrees in psychology and French language and literature from the University of Maryland, College Park, and a master's degree in developmental psychology and neuroscience from Columbia University. Well prepared to talk to us. Let me, could we all please welcome Amy?
Hi, Dad. So I will be speaking fairly briefly today to give you somewhat of an overview of the neurobiological basis of anorexia, which is the subject of my dissertation work. And I hope once I finish speaking, you'll feel free to ask as many questions as you might have. I find this works better as sort of a dialogue as opposed to a didactic presentation, but that being said, I will do my bit first and see what you come up with. So just to give you a brief overview sort of what I will be discussing today, as I completely obstruct your view, we've observed a whole host of variations in brain structure in women with anorexia nervosa, and we've observed these across the spectrum of patients. So when I say that, I have to figure out how to do this in a way that doesn't do that. We've observed these in both women who are currently ill, so those are people people who meet diagnostic criteria today and who have BMIs that fall below what we would consider a healthy weight. And we've also observed these in women who have been previously diagnosed with an eating disorder but have sustained long-term weight recovery. So the purpose of including this group is to try and get a sense of what does this clinical phenotype look like in the absence of a confounding effect of malnutrition. So what might this person's brain look like before the person got sick, and what about that might make them vulnerable to illness in the first place? So in doing so, we've observed variations in brain structure that are both state-dependent. So those would be variations that you see in the first group, but not the second group. And those are largely attributed to malnutrition. And we've also seen variations in brain structure that are trait-based. So those would be seen in both the underweight and weight recovered groups. And those we would attribute either to disease scarring, so that would be some sort of effect on the brain that can't be remediated with long-term weight maintenance, or to some sort of neurodevelopmental difference that probably emerges early in childhood and makes someone vulnerable to an eating disorder in the first place. So first I'm just going to briefly review the state-dependent changes. So these are the changes that we see in underweight patients exclusively that are probably attributed to malnutrition, but have a serious and important impact on disease presentation nonetheless. So what are we talking about here? We're talking about neurons. Neurons are the basic functional units of the brain. They're the energy centers of the brain, and they cluster primarily on two different surfaces. Up here at the top, this is what we call the cortex. And down here, deeper in the brain, and these are what we call subcortical nuclei. And together, the cortex and subcortical nuclei constitute what you routinely hear referred to as the gray matter of the brain. And this is called gray matter because if you were to look at tissue, like a tissue slice on histology, it would actually appear gray. So what's actually going on here is that when people become starved or nutrient deprived, their neurons shrink. So the actual cell bodies become dehydrated, and as a result, they retract. Or those long extensions coming off those cell bodies pull in, and as a result, the neuron in its entirety takes up less space. The functional impact of this shrinkage in neuron is that the gray matter portion of the brain becomes smaller relative to the other parts of the brain. So if you look at this image here, we have a set of identical twins. So these are people whose brains, in the absence of a substantial environmental impact, should look almost identical. And you'll notice that the twin who is not eating disordered has substantially more gray matter in the circled part of the brain than the twin who is eating disordered. And so what we infer from this slide is that the acute malnutrition itself has had a noticeable impact on the brain that's quite evident just with the naked eye. And what happens when that gray matter shrinks or those neurons retract is that the brain compensates by filling up that empty space with fluid. And the reason it does this is that in order to prevent brain injury, so should you hit your head on something, fluid is needed to bathe the brain and to prevent any sort of shaking back and forth from causing tissue damage that would ultimately result in cell death. So you'll notice not only that there's gray matter shrinkage at the top of the image there, but that the ventricles, which are the fluid-filled spaces in the brain, in the underweight twin look substantially larger than they do in the weight-recovered twin. In the non-eating disordered twin. So what you're seeing here on the whole is malnutrition-induced change in the brain that causes the gray matter to retract and that space to be filled with what's called cerebrospinal fluid. Why does this happen? The prevailing theory is that neurons retract and as a result gray matter decreases because malnutrition causes an increase in cortisol. Cortisol, of course, is your stress hormone. In certain situations, cortisol is an extremely beneficial and productive hormone. In this case, cortisol is secreted as an energy conservation measure. So given that you have a finite number of resources, those resources need to be prioritized in the best way possible. In this case, that would be to go to things like breathing and pumping blood and maintaining vital organ function. So neurons in areas of the brain that aren't deemed as critical shrink and as a result require fewer resources. And as you can infer, their function is therefore impaired.
Excuse me, can you say that again?
Sure.
Just said?
So cortisol, which is your stress hormone, generally helps your body maintain a balance, right, between dedicating resources to functions that are crucial for survival and then using whatever's left over to facilitate things like complex cognition and emotion processing. In the absence of sufficient resources, those functions get deprioritized, and the cells or the neurons that are involved in subserving those functions shrink. When they shrink, they require fewer resources, and those resources can then be directed to things like breathing and pumping blood.
So if we have an adolescent that's starving and has been a really good student, when she is this starved, the resources for deep cognitive functioning, deep study, are compromised.
Right, so you raise a really fascinating point because it oftentimes seems like people who are extremely malnourished have this paradoxical ability to focus solely and intently on schoolwork. And I'll come to explain why I think that is in a moment, but it is on its face, you're like, this doesn't compute. But cortisol plays an important role in that too. I'll come back to that. But just again, to sort of explain the function of cortisol, it subserves incredibly important things. If you are in a situation where your life is in danger, generating sufficient cortisol for you to have that fight or flight response is crucial to your survival. In the absence of a threat sufficient to merit that response, cortisol can have a whole host of negative impacts. So these can impact brain function. So they cause things like anhedonia, which is a lack of pleasure, inability to experience pleasure, a lack of motivation, fatigue, difficulty concentrating, anxiety, depression, mood instability. Like all of these things have been used to describe people with eating disorders. And then they have a whole host of physiological effects. Things like impairing immune function, so you're more likely to get sick. Things like metabolic suppression, so your body's ability to process glucose is impaired, fluid retention, visceral fat retention, arterial plaque formation, of course this is the primary cause of heart attack and stroke, insulin resistance, which is a pre-diabetic function, and ultimately peripheral nerve damage. So we're talking about really significant pathophysiological effects of this chronic stress exposure that's situationally inappropriate. And I bring this up because, again, I feel like oftentimes these are medical consequences of eating disorders that are sort of dismissed as being potentially unrelated or somehow tangential to the disorder, when in fact I think they're probably directly related and subserved by the same fundamental mechanism. So ultimately, what are the consequences of the disruption in cortisol production? Neurons within different areas of your brain, pictured here, communicate amongst themselves in such a way as to integrate information necessary to produce higher order functions. So you get input from one part of your brain, for example, that tells you, my stomach feels distended. you get another input from a different part of your brain that says, I feel upset. I feel emotionally dysregulated. I feel unhappy. Your brain then incorporates those pieces of information and learns that when my stomach is distended, I feel upset. And it starts to pair those things in the absence of sufficient reason to do so. So your stomach feels distended, you assume you're emotionally dysregulated. You're emotionally dysregulated, you start to feel that your stomach is distended. So you get these circuits behaving inappropriately, and that could reflect to a certain degree the fact that we have this change in neuron structure that's causing the way these neurons would normally interact with one another to become dysregulated. Where are these changes the most profound? They're the most profound in two regions. One is the insula, pictured, I guess, on your right. No, my right, your left. This is a key part of your brain involved in exactly what I just described, in integrating information that has to do with how I feel physically, how I feel emotionally, how those things drive me to engage in certain behaviors or to make certain choices. So this is a key, what's called interoceptive region, that's been implicated in a whole host of psychiatric and non-psychiatric issues. The other two are the prefrontal cortex, and you've probably heard these mentioned in the context of things like executive function or decision making or assessing risk and reward. So together, these regions are crucial in dictating to what stimuli we pay attention, and then how we use that information to guide our decision making. So for example, I'm faced with the decision of eating food that's been put in front of me. What information do I find more salient? The fact that I'm hungry and that I would probably find eating that food intrinsically rewarding, or the fact that I associate food and weight gain with anxiety and depression and shame and fear and uncertainty. And as a result, I say, while I might find it intrinsically rewarding to eat this now, 2 hours from now, I'm going to feel horrible for having had it. So which of those do I prioritize in my decision making? Typically, a person would say, I'm hungry, it's rewarding, and that's where that conversation would stop. For someone with an eating disorder, that focus gets shifted, and that thought process becomes less salient than the thought process that says, yeah, I'm really hungry, but at the end of the day, this is not going to make me a happier person. And it's sort of that imbalance that we think is somewhat related to structural impairment in these particular regions. So to sort of do a simplistic review of this process, starvation causes excess cortisol production. This in turn produces a change in neuron size, and as a result, a change in the relative proportion of brain tissue volume. This causes disruption in certain key networks known to facilitate things like attention processing and homeostatic functioning. And this dysregulation within network can cause things like extreme threat detection. So I'm perceiving things in my environment as threatening when objectively they're probably not. Or inappropriate response selection. So that's sort of the example I gave. Where do I prioritize the intrinsically rewarding food, or do I prioritize the long-term consequence of eating that food? And then the big one, inaccurate body representation. These particular circuits are heavily implicated in the connection between what we see and how we integrate that in order to create a 3D model of how we occupy space. So I feel like you often hear this narrative of people with eating disorders who, they don't see themselves properly, or, you know, they just, their body image processing is dysregulated, which is just an incredibly simplistic way of saying their signals to their visual system are getting improperly integrated, and as a result, they're not just saying I feel fat or I see fat in the mirror. They are quite literally seeing fat in the mirror. And I think as someone who hasn't experienced that, it's an incredibly difficult thing to wrap your head around. But when you see people performing these tasks on neurocognitive batteries, so for example, people are asked in the total absence of any sort of actual action-oriented behavior to say, you have to walk through a doorway. Show me in terms of size how big that doorway would have to be for you to pass through without bumping on either side. There's no real emotional sort of significance attached to what we're asking you to do here. This is not something that's meant to provoke, you know, some sort of affective response. This is just a question of, here's the amount of space you have, how much do you need? This is sort of a mathematical computation. And what you'll see is that the average person will actually say they need less space than they need. We think we're thinner than we are. But people with eating disorders will vastly overestimate the amount of space that they need, which suggests that there is this visual spatial deficit that exists even in the absence of an affective. So this is not how big do you feel after you've eaten a meal. This is, if you were in a computer game, if you had to build a Sims world, what would that doorway look like? And so that's, I think at least, a really telling indicator of how basic this function is that's dysregulated. And again, that contributes to an accurate body representation. So ultimately, oh, and I'm sorry, this is to come back to your question about studying. This cortisol circuit looks a heck of a lot like post-traumatic stress disorder. And what happens to vets, for example, with PTSD? They hear fireworks going off, and their body reacts as if those are gunshots. And as a result, they shut down all ancillary processing. Their sole focus is, how do I avoid this threat? Well, let's say instead of fireworks, your threat cue is body or food related. Anything you see in your environment or hear in your environment that triggers that response causes you to tunnel vision, to narrow your focus exclusively to that particular stimulus. That's everything. You can't go through any environment without coming across something food or weight related. So you're walking through every minute of every day, activated as if you were in a war zone. And what happens when you're activated like that? Tunnel vision, an ability to focus extremely and exclusively on tiny details. And if that focus is not dedicated to avoiding snipers, it can be redirected to things like studying for an exam. So you get this paradoxical effect of, yes, your cognitive function should be compromised, and objectively it is compromised, but your ability to sit and study without getting up or eating or drinking or going to the bathroom for 18 hours at a time is unparalleled. And that's likely because of this synergistic effect of extreme cortisol causing the rest of your body to say, like, I tug out. And so you have this ability to focus in a way that people will say when they're in recovery, they miss. That is a experience or an ability that makes them feel powerful, and that is taken away when you're in recovery. And that's, quite frankly, a very valid criticism and a very valid point, because the biological basis of that mechanism goes away. But that's...
We often hear from individuals with eating disorders who are getting lower in weight and starving, how much fatter they feel.
Right.
And many times, as family members, it's like, oh, you're just getting skinnier and skinnier. And yet, what they're experiencing is, as you say, paradoxical to what's happening.
In all likelihood, the more underweight they become, the more dysregulated the circuits become, and the more disrupted their visual processing and their spatial orientation becomes. So even though it would seem to an objective viewer just patently false, it can be objectively untrue and subjectively incredibly poignant and significant and motivational. And those two things can coexist if we understand the sort of neurocircuit basis. So as I said, what can we do to fix this? And the people in the audience who are currently ill are really not going to like my answer, and for that I apologize. But really the answer is you got to cut off the process where it starts. The type of learning that's required to interrupt this process and the cortisol inhibition necessary to sort of move past it is not going to happen in the absence of sufficient. And how do we know this? We know this because these brain deficits pretty much disappear once someone has been weight stabilized at or above a minimally low BMI for about a year in the context of relative symptom abstinence. So you have to maintain your BMI, you can't be binging, you can't be purging, and you can't be regularly restricting. So we're talking about like an extraordinary amount of work, and I recognize that. But this is the sort of neurobiological rationale for a refeeding-oriented treatment approach. Because when you refeed, your brain goes from looking like it does on the left, which was the twin I showed you earlier. So having that deficit, oops, in gray matter there, to being largely similar to a healthy control, and again, that increase in ventricular volume pretty much normalizes. The good news here is that your brain's incredibly plastic. Your brain is capable of getting better, at least to a certain degree. The bad news is, by far and away, the best way of accomplishing that is through caloric intake alone. And it's once you reach participant B that your brain is in a position where it's capable of learning new thought patterns and different ways of processing emotionally relevant stimuli that can then help you get to a point where doing those things or feeling those things doesn't feel so threatening and overwhelming. But nutrition is key. Sorry.
Amy, is it for somebody who is, you know, beyond an adolescent where you can actually take them through this and an adult, is there not something that, because they don't see this,
right?
So they're not going to compute this at all. Is there not something that, it's not a magic pill, but is there something that can be provided to reduce the cortisol so that they can get to a stage where they can see the logic.
Right.
Because that's the turning point.
Sure.
And
I'm not a medical doctor, so that would be a better question to ask, for example, an endocrinologist, someone whose job it is to deal with hormone regulation. What I can tell you is that to date, certainly people have tried to do that. And they've been largely ineffective, simply because this is a very strongly evolutionarily ingrained response. This is a biological mechanism that has allowed humans to survive for many, many years, and as a result, it's probably not going to be easily remedied with a simple pharmaceutical drug. There are certainly techniques.
Mm-hmm.
That you can use to try and offset some of the cortisol. primary target of treatment here. I'm sure if you can think of one, the drug companies would be more than happy to. Yeah. So that's sort of what goes on in your brain when you're sick. And as I hope you've sort of taken away from that, being sick in and of itself causes a whole host of changes that might not necessarily have been there to begin with, but certainly don't help things. They probably make your symptoms worse. They probably bring on a set of symptoms you didn't necessarily have to begin with. But the good news is they're highly treatable with sort of the appropriate intervention. What doesn't necessarily look so malnutrition driven? So here we're talking about neurons and glia. And glia are cells that encircle axons as their myelin sheaths. So that's this pink sort of odd substance pictured here. And the function of myelin is that it works much like an insulation around an electrical wire works. It prevents the electrical wire from being impacted by things in the environment, but it also speeds transmission of information along that electrical wire. And collectively, bundles of axons are referred to as white matter. And again, this is simply because if you look at a tissue histology section, myelin is a fatty substance. On tissue, it looks white. It's pretty simple. So, what's going on to cause these changes that we see not only in people who are currently sick, but also in people who have been previously sick and for all intents and purposes have brains that look much like those of healthy controls? Probably what's going on is these glia aren't assembling properly early in development, and as a result, what would normally be intact myelin is compromised. And what is the significance of this? The significance is that messages that would normally be relayed appropriately from neuron to neuron, again, within the context of those larger circuits, those messages become distorted. So I like to think of this much like I think of the game Telephone you played as a little kid, where you had people sitting in a line whispering into an ear, and then you pass the message along. And inevitably, by the end, the message sounds nothing like it was at the beginning. That's basically the effect of compromised myelin. I also like to think of it as, this is the really good Wi-Fi network, and this is the Wi-Fi network that cuts out every 30 seconds, so you get like half of the message, and then you piece it together and end up with something totally wrong. So the question, of course, that is why. Why might we have myelin deficits in the brain that make someone more vulnerable to an eating disorder because they cause all sorts of circuit-wide disruption akin to being on a bad Wi-Fi network? Well, this is a complicated question, and it's probably a combination of both genetics, what were you born with, and Amy does a really wonderful job of illustrating this in her poem when she says, something you're either susceptible or you're not, and she's completely true. The genetic component of eating disorders are enormous, and it's on the scale of things like schizophrenia, it's significantly higher than depression. People really underestimate the degree to which this is a heritable illness, but it is also influenced by things like environment. So things like nutrition, things like exercise, things like, were you exposed to nicotine either yesterday or when your mother was pregnant? What have you learned? Have you been in a resource-enriched environment? Did your parents talk to you constantly when you were a child, or were you left in front of cartoons for 25 hours a day? So again, this is a really complex picture that starts very early. And we're still in the midst of disentangling these mechanisms. I like to think we're getting a little bit closer, but it's a slow and steady climb, not a sprint. But the takeaway is that these both probably contribute substantially. So you're probably a product of the genes that you inherited from mom and dad. Those shape how your brain develops. And the trajectory of that development is then also impacted by things like, did you happen to be exposed to a traumatic event early in childhood that caused that process to take a different turn? Or did you sustain a head injury that caused that process to become delayed? All sorts of things can have synergistic effects with that genetic risk to produce a brain that might not look like it would in someone who hadn't had either that genetic risk or those environmental exposures.
Amy, sorry, is this specific to anorexia? Or is it the genetic and the environmental factors? Is it, does it also affect the other eating disorders?
So anorexia is considered a more heritable eating disorder than bulimia. But both are certainly heritable. I'm not aware of the current statistics on binge eating disorders. It's fairly new. So I don't want to misrepresent that by trying to speak to the heritability of that disorder. But certainly genetics and environment both play crucial roles in shaping the brains of people with anorexia and bulimia. It's probably a stronger genetic component in people with anorexia than bulimia. But as I'm sure you know, the two coexist so frequently. They're such high disorder, sort of, for lack of a better term, flip-flopping, that, again, studying that can be difficult in and of itself. Sure. So when people talk about peripheral nerve damage, which is in essence what neuropathy is, that's exactly what they're talking about. They're talking about a decrease in the density or the integrity of the myelin, and as a result, poor transmission of impulses along those nerves.
So because we talk about cognition, but would it not affect the rest of the neurons?
Absolutely. So it has impacts well beyond the brain into the periphery, and one of those impacts is things like nerve insensitivity. So people not feeling things in their fingers and their toes as well as they might otherwise. Generally, those are the areas that are the first to be impacted.
We often see in very starved anorexics foot dropping.
Yeah, exactly. That precisely. Which is probably also attributable to circulation deficits, but in a progressed enough illness would almost certainly reflect a myelin deficit.
Amy, can you just like explain what the question was and your response?
Sure. The question was, could myelin deficits impact things like peripheral nerve function? And one example of that was dropped foot, so things like losing feeling in your fingers and toes. And my response was that it certainly could. Myelin is what causes these impulses to be sent from your brain down your limbs. So if the myelin isn't as structurally sound, those impulses get lost, in essence, or their strength diminishes over space. And as a result, the impulse that originates in your brain by the time it gets to your fingertips might be substantially weakened, and you might ultimately not feel what you were intended to feel.
So if you have symptoms of clinical neuropathy while in an illness state, is that considered one of the things that can be reversed, or is it?
As I said, I'm not a medical doctor. What I can say is that there's good evidence of myelin regeneration. There's good evidence that your nerves can recover lost myelin. That is in a very controlled environment where you're talking about depriving certain cells of certain things, you know, for example, in rats, and looking at whether or not they can recoup those functions. It's a lot harder, obviously, to then generalize that to humans. So as far as I would be comfortable saying is that there's good evidence that that's possible. I don't know well enough from a clinical clinical standpoint, what the remission rates are on that, to give you an answer beyond that.
You were mentioning before the example of the twins.
Mm-hmm.
So one could be below the BMI and the other one above. So how would that reflect? Is the DNA, or is it like you said, one was watching, was it eating or was not eating? Like,
right. So twins, identical twins, at least share 100% of their DNA. So they are a perfect example of how it's not just genetics. And ultimately, the way they determine disease heritability is by looking at, in how many sets of identical twins, if you have a disorder in one twin, do you also have it in the other? So in eating disorders, in about 70% of the case that one twin has it, the other twin will also have it. But in 30%, the other twin won't. And so what causes that difference, as opposed to it being 100 and 100, is that you probably have one twin that had an environmental exposure that the other twin didn't. So both show up with a baseline vulnerability. One twin has an experience that the other doesn't have. That experience exacerbates some sort of vulnerability. And at the end of the day, that twin manifests biologically something that the twin who's not sick does not. So that is what you're describing is the environmental component. But assuming all things being equal, if one twin had it, you would expect the other twin to have it about 70% of the time. And that's a very high heritability rate for a psychiatric disorder.
If you don't have the genetic propensity, but you have a strong environmental exposure, can you conclusively say that one's going to develop anorexia? I guess what I'm saying is, can you develop anorexia without the genetic exposure?
That's a difficult question to ask because it's predicated upon the assumption that the genetic exposure is sort of as simple as A or B, and it's incredibly multifactorial. So we're not talking about, like when you were in high school biology and you did those circles and squares to see if you'd have blue eyes or brown eyes. It'd be really nice if it worked that way. But you're talking about, on the whole, additively, across the entire genome, and we don't even really necessarily know which gene loci we're talking about. So the short answer is I can't answer that question until we can map the genetic vulnerability to the point where we can say, with a blood test, you either have it or you don't. What I feel comfortable saying is that in the absence of enough of that genetic variability, it's extremely unlikely that you would develop an eating disorder. And so I guess the best example of that is, you look at people who've been exposed to early sexual trauma, and there's a very high rate of eating disorders in that group, but certainly not everyone in that group has an eating disorder. And that's probably what we're talking about here, is that it's not sufficient just to have the environmental exposure. Without a doubt, the environmental exposure will cause some sort of response. It's unlikely that response would have an eating disorder presentation to it, simply because the sort of presentation of an eating disorder is so fundamentally maladaptive. You really have to have a very calibrated set of genetics for your body to identify that particular pattern as a better coping response.
Terry, we have a webinar participant with a question, again related to heritability. So they're wondering if, their question is a child at higher risk of having anorexia if her mother also had it as a teen? And if so, what kind of risk would it be?
Certainly those numbers are out there. I can't quote them off the top of my head. I can tell you that having a parent who has had an eating disorder is a risk factor for having an eating disorder oneself, but so is having a mother who was depressed. So it's not necessarily a sort of linear transmission pattern, and I wouldn't go nearly close to saying that if your mom has an eating disorder, you are going to have an eating disorder. It's much more indirect a transmission than that. But to answer the question, yes, you are at higher risk. I would be hesitant to put numbers on it again because we're talking about an algorithm that computes probability based on like 100 input variables. So simply knowing one input variable, I could give you a number, but it would be a guess, and I would rather not do that.
Okay, thank you.
So again, I feel like I've sort of alluded to this, but much like the decrease in neuron size, inadequate myelination can alter the way that neural networks are organized and ultimately the way they function. And this can produce pathological states. So they've mapped changes in neural structure and function to things like extremely high levels of anxiety, things like being intensely rigid in your thought process, things like having a difficult time shifting from one task to another. So these are all things that exist very much on the spectrum of normal, but in an extreme manifestation could very well reflect these sort of finely tuned changes in network structure or function that arise as a result of these very nuanced changes in brain structure. Where are these greatest? So we see these myelin deficits and as a result changes in white matter organization, particularly along what's called the corpus callosum. This is the brain's biggest white matter tract. It's the tract that integrates information across hemispheres. So anything that's processed on one part of the brain, for example, on the right side, if it has a left side corollary, it's that information is going to have to be integrated across the corpus callosum. This tract is involved in basically everything. To say this is the most implicated is not so helpful because it's so nonspecific. But it speaks to how systemic and systematic this white matter deficit is. We also see it in these longer association tracts, which, much like the corpus callosum, are involved in integrating information from different parts of the brain, but in this case, rather than being from one side to the other, it's from the back. So as again, a simplistic overview of what I just described, genetic variance and environmental exposure can give rise to things like insufficient myelination of the brain. Having had an eating disorder can also cause what we call excess glial apoptosis, which is just programmed cell death, so much like your neurons shrink in the absence of sufficient resources. Your glial cells that myelinate those fibers might be pruned as a result of having had an illness. These changes give rise to compromised white matter, and as a result to inefficient communication or changes in the structure of those neural networks. And this can ultimately manifest as increased disease vulnerability, so things like being extremely anxious, things like having a high harm avoidance. So harm avoidance is a sort of term for behavioral inhibition. So how sort of hesitant someone is to pursue a particular action, particularly if there's a perceived uncertainty about how potentially rewarding or potentially risky that action might be. So some people just, you know what, if there's a chance it's going to work, I'm going to go for it. This is sort of the opposite of that. Like, in the absence of 95% certainty that this is going to work out the way I want it to work out, not interested. And low cognitive flexibility. So I alluded to that earlier. This is sort of this inability to shift cognitive set. So I like to use the example of, again, I know or I think that eating makes me fat and depressed, and as a result, I don't want to do it. That's my cognitive set. But I have 8 doctors telling me that eating will make me feel happier. It's not going to make me fat. In fact, it's highly unlikely that my BMI is going to get above the minimally accepted level. And I'm inundated with those messages, but I can't seem to internalize them and change how I think. Why might that be? That's because I'm having a very difficult time set shifting. I'm having a difficult time integrating new information, taking that information, and changing my attitudes and behaviors accordingly. I'm hearing it. It's not that I'm not hearing it. It's just that I'm not necessarily believing it. Or I'm not believing it enough. It's not feeling compelling enough that it's going to shape how I respond in the future. And I imagine as a parent or a caregiver or a clinician, that's an incredibly frustrating process to have to come up against time and time again. Say, I'm giving you all of this information. Look at this information. Why are you not? You're so smart. Why aren't you taking this information? This is what we call impaired cognitive flexibility. This is not, I don't understand, or I'm not listening. This is, I cannot internalize what you're telling me.
And you mean the factor of fear is in there as well, right? The fear of the unknown, the fear
absolutely.
Of what if, I'm going to get fat if I eat. So that fear is really prominent in the brain.
And that's, that's sort of, I think, where the harm avoidance plays in,
right.
Is that people who are highly harm avoidant are exceptionally fear-driven. So, again, I'm not going to pursue a certain course of action unless you can tell me with almost 100% certainty that that action is going to give me a particular outcome. I'm not willing to take those odds at anything less than 95% or higher. And if you don't take those odds, then you can see how it would be really hard to sort of make that leap.
I really feel that interrupting this, but hi, Teddy. Hi. I just feel like I have to speak out. This is okay. I'm a survivor of an eating disorder. I used to see Teddy. I haven't seen him in a long time. I feel bad that I'm like taking over the forum, but I just feel like I can't not say this to whoever here is suffering or whatever. I lost my marriage over an eating disorder. I'm from New York originally. I'm going to cry when I say this. I came to Toronto, and I had an eating disorder somewhat before I got married, but nothing near what I did. But I don't want to interrupt your whole thing because you're speaking amazing, but I just want to speak to what you were saying exactly. When someone's in the midst of an eating disorder, there's no talking sense to them. I mean, I see a bunch of young girls here. I don't know who's struggling and who's not struggling. All I can say is that it is, like Dr. What's the name from Trump General? Dr. Westside said to me as soon as I came into the program, the first time I ever stepped, you're about to do the second most hardest thing in your life, and that is getting over the eating disorder. The most difficult thing in the entire world is living with an eating disorder, and I totally second that. It is an illness that is hell on earth, and it makes no sense. It really makes no sense. I mean, I have so much to say because I've been through so much. And I live in Toronto, or I remain in Toronto with 2 children alone because I'm a mom and whatever. I've been all over the world for help because of my eating disorder. I was left with a gastrointestinal issue as a result of it, and I don't want to take away from it, but I just want to tell you that this is so true, that anyone that is in the midst of an eating disorder, my parents used to come into the programs, used to say, like, what is going on here? These girls are all stunning and brilliant. And they just can't do the simplest thing, eat. people that actually get through it and realize and see the light, it's clearly a result of genetics and environment. And I always feel like if I could get up in front of like a sea of people and tell these girls, you guys don't know what you're getting into. I mean, obviously I'm an Orthodox Jewish mother, and I lost a lot of what our life stands for over this illness.
I mean, I can put all the diaries.
And I will say that by the time I got divorced, I was very much on the mend, but my husband just could not hold out anymore. Emotionally, he was gone. So, and I think, I feel like I should be doing what you're doing. You're amazing.
Do you think, one of the things that I'm hearing from this is, as clinicians, with this kind of knowledge, can we help the client to say, this isn't going to make any sense to you? It's not gonna work. It's not gonna feel good.
I think the girls are bright enough to know that it makes no. I mean, all the girls in Eat Sorts, I've been through several programs. They all know that this is so ridiculous. They know, and they know that while they're there, they're walking out, and they may, and they're probably gonna end up back in one of these programs 6 months later. They know that, but they can't get themselves to do what they need to do.
If I could just address that, my daughter was where we were with Dr. Woodside's TPH. And when we went into treatment, the first thing he told us was to expect a relapse rate. This is why this is so interesting, because 60%. That was enough to make my daughter look at us and say, why the hell are we here? Because she knew the suffering she had ahead of her, if she was brave enough to see it through. So 60% is not very reassuring. So what I'm getting from your science, because that's what we're learning about today, is minus the calories, there is no recovery, from my understanding, for anorexia, because you need weight. So if you're severely malnourished at a 14 BMI, you can talk to the most intelligent, as my daughter is as well, human being, it's not going to happen. I think what he meant to say is, we're going to get you physically strong so quickly, because we need you out in 12 weeks, there's beds that need to be filled. And then there's going to be, hopefully, a continuation of the mind catching up with a lot of grueling work for the next 2, 3, 4, she's 5 years into recovery now. Or you're going to be back here.
Yeah.
But you'll probably be back with a little bit of, hopefully, extra weight, a little bit more, okay, I've done this once, I can do this again, and maybe that's why some people need 4 times, 5 times, 6 times. We did it the second time on the outside, outpatient. But without that weight, from everything you're explaining, there is no other way. There's no magic wand here. There's no, you cannot recover from that degree of anorexia with putting without getting to a healthy body weight, because your brain can't recover.
And then maintain it.
And then maintain it.
In order
so
to
the brain and the body have to kind of work together here, right? For, I think, recovery at long term.
So the thing to add to that, just to, and you're the expert in this, but I think, and it's interesting, I've worked in outpatient at Oakville Trafalgar, and as the individual, the young person, was eating more, she was getting more re-nourished, and she was cognitively better. So I think with the food and the cognition go hand in hand. I think that's what you're trying to say. So recovery is possible. I think it's more in terms of all the other factors, family factors, your motivation to get better, what's helping you get better, are your friends supportive? So I think it's a whole combination for recovery to happen. I think that, you know, family piece is really important. And the motivation is really important. So I think that
I agree, but I don't believe you could recover without the weight.
Yeah.
That's
well,
right.
Exactly.
Right. You definitely need all the other factors, but
right.
you need to bring your weight up to a point where your brain a lot of this stuff is getting recharged as the weight comes on. Without it, you can't.
So yeah, as a nutrition helps, right? Your cognition
physiologically.
Yeah.
Okay. Going back to the twins just for a second, was one of them in recovery, or was one of them not ever suffering?
One had never had an eating disorder, and the other had an active eating disorder. And then in the second picture I showed, I contrasted the twins. to a woman who is the same age and had been ill the same length of time, but had maintained weight recovery for at least a year. So to demonstrate that we see these differences in identical twins that are probably environmentally driven, and then we see that those environmental changes can be remediated, because if they couldn't, you wouldn't expect to see the same degree of sort of brain health in a weight recovered person as you would in a twin who's never had any weight disorder.
And when you're talking about genetics, you know, without perhaps all the statistics yet behind it, I know it's a really difficult aspect to sort of bend the poles. You talked about, and it was a question asked about the probability, the possibility of a median sort of passed from mother to daughter.
Mm-hmm.
There are some statistics, but are there any statistics? Let's look across the sexes. I mean, eating disorders are not strictly a woman's
right
issue. But are there studies indicating anything genetically from mother to son or from?
Not that I know of. I would imagine if they looked at the rates of eating disorders in mothers of sons who have eating disorders, they would find similarly elevated levels. I don't think that any of the genetic component is necessarily so sex-based that you would expect female children to necessarily be at substantially higher risk than male children. I just don't think there's enough beyond sort of like maybe something hormonal related. You're given a set of genetics, and I think probably those same genetics passed on to a male child would have a risk, would impart risk as they would to a female child. You might, however, raise that male child in an environment that's less triggering than you would a female child, just based on how sort of the culture that we live in. But to answer your question, I think if they looked at the mothers of male anorexics, they'd find almost the identical prevalence rate.
And just one last comment, I guess. There were a couple of comments or questions concerning the need, and I simply put, and I think it's perfectly put, you know, if somebody's malnourished, it doesn't matter what you say to them, it's, you know, it's not going to be huge. And it really does, I think, to the border of maybe into the area of addiction.
Absolutely.
You know, I mean, it's the same thing. It's like trying to take somebody who's an alcoholic and trying to make them understand what the issues are with alcoholism while they're drinking. And you can't do it.
I mean, I think there's a similar process going on where the line of reasoning you're using isn't necessarily going to be a persuasive or effective tool for shaping that person's behavior. And I always think eating disorders are really fall very neatly into the spectrum of addiction, with one major exception. You would never tell a person with an eating disorder, oh, this is really simple, you just figure out how to live your life without food. Much like you would encourage someone in AA to pursue sobriety. So I think it takes on the same underlying deficit and adds a whole other level of complexity when you say, but you're going to have to learn to live with your substance in moderation.
No, but you told the alcoholic that part of the recovery is based on what they're drinking. So if you said, drink all the water you want.
Sure,
so
absolutely.
I mean, it's the same thing. So what you're saying to somebody that might be an anorexic is, you need to be against,
yes,
in order for us to properly move through the program.
Right, and you're
going to
need it.
There's no question.
And it's probably not going to feel good.
Right.
Amy, what can you, assumption being that all of the neurological deficits lead to these cognitive distortions, what do you make of a situation where, like, for myself, I can see my body for what it is. I can see that it is sick. I see it not with that distortion, but
So you could certainly have someone that has fairly accurate body processing, but still has this incredibly ingrained, learned association between eating and feeling awful, or uncertainty and a lack of control, and those associations might fuel the disorder just as much as they would in someone who has a really impaired body image representation.
Where my concern for myself lies, or just with that question, is if you have some of those ideas about yourself intact, does that make a process more challenging? Because those, like, you can't shift the cognition to understand what it already understands.
Right. I think probably it's on the balance across all of these domains, right? So there are people that are really intact with their body processing, but might have a stronger learned association between eating and experiencing overwhelming anxiety. And so for those people, a focus of treatment is going to be unlearning that association, and that's going to be harder for them than teaching someone who might not have that to the same degree, but really can't see themselves accurately, to get a better sense of themselves in space. I don't think necessarily having one to a greater or a lesser degree has prognostic implications, unless across the board you have everything or nothing. I think it's a very carefully calibrated system, so I wouldn't necessarily say simply because you view yourself accurately means you're any less likely to get better. It's just the focus of that treatment is probably going to be somewhat different.
Is it normal for people to, when they look at themselves in a mirror or in a photo, to see themselves as ill, but then they walk away from the mirror, but from the inside out, they feel like they're constantly expanding?
Yeah, I think what you described is not necessarily an incompatible set of symptoms, right? So maybe my visual processing is really intact, and I can look in the mirror and I see that I look ill.
Yeah.
But I close my eyes, and when I eat, I can feel the fat cells in my arms. I can feel them growing bigger, I can feel my stomach extending, and I know, realistically, that when I look in a mirror, I look emaciated, but when I eat, I feel like I'm ballooning. I think those two things can completely coexist, and it's just a different variation on that theme of, is my deficient processing in integrating visual stimuli, or is it integrating this, how does my body feel, and how am I feeling emotionally? It's just a different aspect of the same.
Yeah, I'm just kind of frustrated with people saying that you essentially lack the ability to reason when you can see yourself as sick. It's just not enough to make yourself be well because it's serving a purpose.
Yeah, I don't think any of this is about having a lack of reasoning ability. I think at the end of the day, it's about taking all of the various pieces you have and at that moment putting them on a scale and saying, is the potential benefit of not doing this outweighed by the negative experiences I have from doing it? And I think ultimately what's going to make treatment effective for people is getting to the point where they're healthy enough to make new learned associations, and then very slowly tipping those scales. And that's an incredibly complex process, and I do not envy the clinicians that have to try and figure out the mechanics of it. But I think you're doing a disservice to people with eating disorders by saying they're just fundamentally irrational. I think some of their beliefs are irrational, but their computation is actually quite mathematically precise. I think you could probably say it's a simple cost-benefit. It's just that how they weigh certain costs versus how they weigh certain benefits is not in line with how the average person might weigh those same costs and benefits.
Sorry to interrupt. If it's possible to speak a little bit louder, some of the folks in the webinar are having trouble hearing.
Certainly. Let me just get through these next like two or three slides, and then I think it'll be easier to just field questions. So what I wanted to say briefly is just that some of these differences in white matter that are probably developmental in origin can also become worse when someone is acutely ill. And so you might actually see that some of these temperamental risk factors become more prominent. And I think that goes very much to this shift in how one weighs what is sort of, if you think of discrete pieces of information, in ultimately making a decision. How those pieces of information get weighed is probably off to begin with, and then when you're sick, becomes even more biased. So, what can be done? This is, of course, the million-dollar question. And I do like to point out here that in isolation, these things on their own aren't necessarily bad. So when we look at the brains of people with anorexia, and the brains of their sisters who don't have anorexia, we see certain things in the sisters' brains that we do not see in healthy control brains. Those sisters don't look exactly like what we would consider a neurotypical person. Those sisters have some of these deficits, and some of these deficits probably make those sisters empathetic, sensitive, bright, focused. They contribute to the same personality traits that, if blown out of proportion, can be really dangerous. So what we need to do is figure out how to prevent those traits from reaching a critical mass where they become disruptive and keep them at a point where they're advantageous. How can we get these brains of the sick sisters to look a little bit more like the healthy sisters so that they're getting all of the good stuff without getting all of the bad stuff? And there's a lot of research going on right now to try and do exactly that. And most of it has to do with modulating how these neurons communicate with one another within larger networks, improving the efficiency of these communication modes, and sort of relearning associations that have been learned that aren't serving a good purpose. And there are a couple ways of doing this that we have good evidence for. CBT does seem to be really effective, but again, in the context of weight stabilization and the appropriate sort of supports, there's good evidence that mindfulness meditation can actually contribute to rewiring of neural circuits. And this is particularly apparent with infula-based networks. So I was talking earlier about the infula and how it's involved in integrating things between the body and the brain. Mindfulness has been shown to be a really effective way of strengthening some of those associations. I personally am really bad at mindfulness. I find it incredibly frustrating. But I think it's probably something that would be a simple tool for people to integrate, and I say this like I'm not getting any money from the mindfulness people. And then slightly more intensive modality is RTMS, which is pairing electrical pulses to try and increase or decrease communication between neurons within different circuits. This has shown really strong efficacy in people with depression who haven't responded well to conventional antidepressant treatment. It's being piloted in people with eating disorders. There's evidence that RTMS actually improves myelin content along white matter tract, so these paired pulses might in fact cause myelin to regenerate when it would otherwise be impaired or deficient. These are really early days though, and I would caution anyone, I'm not saying RTMS is a miracle cure, but I think there's promise there. So just to wrap up and then to get back to your questions, we know that anorexia is associated with changes in brain structure. Some of these seem to be driven by malnutrition and can be remediated with weight stabilization. Others are probably more neurodevelopmental in origin and with appropriate treatment can probably be improved upon, but again, are probably also advantageous to a certain degree if modulated appropriately. And so I do think there's hope. I think a lot of people get better. We don't necessarily know exactly why they get better, and that's really frustrating. And as I'm sure everyone here knows, we don't have great tools for helping people get better. But the work is certainly being done. I'm going to a conference tomorrow in Germany that is all eating disorder neuroscience researchers from around the world. That's why my slide said September 12th, because I'm actually on Europe time. But what I would also say is that progress requires participation. This is not a disorder that we're going to figure out with animal models. We cannot get mice to do this. It's simply too human a phenomenon. Mice don't have sufficiently complex frontal cortices to exhibit the types of behaviors and the really calculated reasoning that we've described. And so I would highly encourage anyone who is willing to participate. Some people in the audience already have. Thank you very much. We appreciate it. I put my contact information here. I'm also happy to direct people to ongoing studies for things like RTMS if they're interested. But I think at the end of the day, we can make an enormous amount of progress if people are willing to come forward and contribute. So obviously the fact that you're here means you're interested. So I applaud that, and I will now resume questions where I was before.
As a parent of long-standing anorexia, that's the most frustrating part, because we can see that there's hope and they can look better. But I know they're not purposely illogical, but that's where it's so frustrating. You know, because you're watching your child die for lack of her inability to reason them, to be able to reason. And it's awful. And there are other years with adult daughters, I'm sure. That's what's frustrating.
I have two questions. One is, something in the brain that is a correlation between anorexia and obesity?
That's a really fascinating question, and I think it's one that's being explored right now. Is there a relationship between brain deficits or circuitry differences in anorexia and in obesity on the flip side? I mean, I'm not sufficiently well versed to the obesity research. No, you could be totally right. And I just, I'm not sure. Yeah, no, and I just, what I don't ever want to do is give misinformation. So I think there's a lot of research being done right now to look at whether anorexia is the flip side of binge eating disorder. I think there's some interesting similarities, but I think the general sort of stance is that they are two quite separate illnesses that might have some, in the brain they look, I think they look more different than they do in life.
There was a recent article in the International Journal of Eating Disorders, and it looked at people who were grossly overweight, so were obese, had BMI of over 35, and who lost weight and kept it off, and the, how they correlated with behaviors of an individual with anorexia. And they were very, very high in terms of the way in which the weight recovered, weight restored, obese person managed food and eating was very similar to the way an anorexic manages food.
I think probably in both cases you're talking about people whose baseline functioning is strongly dysregulated, so there's a learning and a sort of mechanical repetition to behavior that I'm not necessarily sure someone who had an eating disorder in the past is by default going to end up at a healthy weight eating like someone who eats intuitively and has eaten intuitively his or her own life. I think it's certainly possible, but I think in some cases people will be able to maintain a healthy weight simply repeating and mimicking behaviors that they've observed other people doing or they've been taught to do. And in that case, my guess is it's a very similar process in people who were previously obese who learned that the way to maintain your weight is by calorie counting and portion control, and I can't necessarily eat whenever I'm hungry. The same way someone who is anorexic might not be able to maintain a healthy weight if they only eat when they feel hungry. They might have to learn a system that's not innately tuned to their biological signaling, but it's just what they need to do to survive.
And the other question that I have is, I heard, and correct me if I'm wrong, that sometimes the anorexic people have, they're very smart, and they're very focused. But you were mentioning that the brain shrinks. So is there any relation with Alzheimer? Because at the Alzheimer level, the brain also shrinks.
Right.
So how could they be so smart when yet a person with Alzheimer, and Alzheimer is not only in old age, like you can start
right
quite early, develops the same shrinkage
sure
of the brain?
So brain volume and intelligence aren't necessarily very strongly related to one another. It's a more nuanced relationship than that. So in Alzheimer's, you see global atrophy, but you also see region-specific atrophy, particularly in memory processing centers. So you see this unique pathology that's related to brain volume loss. But one, in Alzheimer's, it's probably not capable of reconstitution the way it is in anorexia. And two, it's probably a different mechanism causing the change that you're observing. So on their face, they might look similar, but the cognitive deficits, I think, characteristic of Alzheimer's are quite different than the cognitive deficits characteristic of anorexia.
Slightly different note, but I wanted to make sure that I mentioned that we have a lot of thanks from the viewers on the webinar for the presentation, including a participant of the study who's thanking you for your research and for doing the presentation and wishing they could be here to see it in person. We also had a question from a webinar viewer, so I'm just going to read it
sure.
the way they've written it, saying that I understand the importance of being weight restored in order for the negatively impacted areas of the brain to recover and to become healthier again. Have you come across any connections between brain health and recovery and estrogen levels? So they're curious about if a person has been weight restored and their menstruation hasn't returned, if lower estrogen levels have any impact on recovery of the brain.
I think, and again, what I feel comfortable saying is that there is a strong relationship between estrogen production and secretion and the brain's ability to reconstitute, and that's been demonstrated. The research on that is very much complicated by the fact that most women nowadays are on hormonal contraception, and so you're talking about an artificial induction of estrogen production. So that can sort of complicate that picture, but to answer their question in the sort of most literal sense, yes, I do think there's been a demonstrated link between resumption of normal menses and the brain's ability to fully and sort of holistically recover. I wouldn't necessarily go so far as to say that someone who's weight recovered but hasn't resumed their menses isn't also then capable of doing that. But there's definitely a known association between the two.
Thank you.
Amy, does neuroplasticity differ based on age? Like, is your brain more able to recover to that?
Right, there's definitely an effect of aging on neuroplasticity, but when people are talking about aging effects, generally they're talking about neuroplasticity decline beginning well after menopause. So you're not talking necessarily about the difference between someone who's 16 and 35 as much as you are between someone who's 35 and 60. So it's a later trajectory where that plasticity starts to decline substantially.
And what was the average age of your participants thus far, just out of curiosity?
Our average underweight
category that I was in, so the underweight one.
So our average participants were in their early 30s. Their average age of onset was 15, so their average disease durations for the underweight group was between 10 and 15. For the weight recovered group was between 7 and 10. So these are people who've been ill quite a substantial period of time, and we're not late teens, early 20s, and we replicated very much the patterns that I'm describing here. I don't know if that answers your question. But we did have people in the study as old as late 40s.
Did their brains look worse?
Their brains looked worse in a way that was age appropriate. The MRI tech has a fun game where you try to guess the age of the people by looking at their brain without having any information, and couldn't really, you know, this is an older person, but it's not like the person looked 85 years old.
I'm taking from the institution, my nation, that it circles back to the fact of high anxiety. And that I'm hearing weight restoration as being sort of the only avenue from which recovery is possible.
I think there are people that get better who don't achieve that first. It's more of a gradual process. I think there's good evidence that prognostically you're more likely to get better the earlier you receive treatment and the shorter length of time you've been sick. I wouldn't say that someone who's currently underweight is not willing to pursue a full-on refeeding treatment program can't get better. I think based on what we understand about the brain, it's going to be a lot more difficult. But there are all sorts of mechanisms that we don't understand, and maybe for some people, some of that learning can take place earlier, and that learning facilitates a willingness to gain weight in a sort of reverse order than we would typically expect, which is you gain weight and then your brain is sort of sufficiently able to make those cognitive and emotional gains.
I find that sort of my experience has been that the mental health system has treated anorexia as a disorder unto its own and will not look outside of the illness, so that somebody who has very high anxiety and they were able to get into a program that addresses anxiety, they might have some success. But there's a tendency of saying, well, our programs don't address eating disorders.
Right. My experience with that, and again, I'm not a clinician, is that a lot of the programs that are for comorbid disorders feel ill-equipped to deal with the medical consequences of eating disorders that require treatment alongside the more psychological processes. I don't think that anyone should be turned away from a treatment they're interested in pursuing because they have an eating disorder,
but I have found that to be the
Well, I'm sorry. But I do think there are medical and legal implications to treating people with eating disorders that are quite complex, and I'm not a lawyer, so I can't speak to those, but I do think there are considerations that are taken into account.
Is a lot of what you're studying and learning about for the prevention side of it, for recognizing the hereditary aspect and trying to, because I'm sure a lot of it has to do with the hopeful cure one day, but is the prevention something that you're working on?
I think prevention is possible in the sense that if we identify enough risk factors, we can target treatment strategies more appropriately very early on. I think you have people that are going years and years without getting recognized, and by the time they're treated appropriately, they've been sick for so long that these patterns are extremely ingrained and therefore very resistant to sort of restructuring. I don't think we're ever going to have a blood test that says, like, that kid is going to have an eating disorder, but I do think we might have middle school guidance counselors that are trained to identify kids at particularly high risk and to monitor those kids more closely and to intervene in ways that are effective. So not showing them videos of people throwing up in closets, but addressing what might actually be going on at a more fundamental level and redirecting those kids in a healthier way. That's my idea of prevention.
Yeah.
I think general practitioners and pediatricians as well would fit into it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think everyone in this room can come up with a really nice list of things please don't say to people. I mean, just simple as that, like messages that are often reiterated that serve much more harm than good. So if even just as simple as getting people to understand that telling someone just to eat is a really ineffective and sort of patronizing way of trying to approach.
Where does deep brain stimulation fit in?
DBS is an alternative to our TMS, but it's extremely invasive and is really, to my knowledge, only recommended for people that have exhausted all other treatment options. But certainly DBS does much what our TMS does in that it modulates network function, and because you can implant the electrode at a much deeper level of the brain, you can target wider regions and circuits that are otherwise inaccessible. So I think there's good evidence to suggest that it can be efficacious, but it's extremely invasive. And I, as a non-clinician and a non-surgeon, would say that I think that should be a last resort treatment. And it makes me nervous when I hear of young people considering that as a first line option.
Two more questions.
Yes. I'm a little bit of an anomaly.
Okay.
Can you speak a little louder?
Sorry, I'm also a survivor. I suffered with both anorexia and bulimia for half of my life, but I didn't go to any treatment. I healed myself on my own. And my question was, my illness was so bad that all of my teeth had to be replaced, so it's, not a very good situation. I'm a little bit nervous here. Do you need many people like me who were able to recover on their own?
It has not been my experience, but again, most of the people that I've met have come through a hospital-based referral system. So I think studying people who have had an alternative path to recovery is incredibly important. It could be just as illuminating as studying people who've taken a more traditional approach.
Mm-hmm.
To answer your question, no, I haven't.
Mm-hmm.
But I think we can gain extremely valuable insight from saying what might enable someone to use this set of skills to recover it in a way that's different from what we typically see.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I never want to convey the message that things are impossible or not realistic. I'm simply speaking sort of at a general probabilistic level, what have we seen seems to be the most effective way of doing things.
Mm-hmm.
But you're certainly not the only person that I've met who said, I was able to sort of use tools and resources that I had access to, and whatever gets you there is wonderful and should be applauded.
I think it would be a great value for you and other clinicians to speak to people like me, because my mode of healing myself is probably very different than what you will get in a program, but I mean, it worked for me. And to be honest, I have relapsed. There are very few times in my life that when I have relapsed, I didn't feel guilty about it. I just realized I'm not perfect and that recovery looks different for everybody. And I got over it and then continued on with my life. But what was very important for me was having goals, right? And eating in a certain way that taught me to not fear food. And quite honestly, I still have certain rules, but they're not quite as rigid as they used to be. But actually, the way I eat would be considered very healthy for nowadays. And it's been workable for me. And I think it might be very valuable for people like yourself.
Absolutely.
But you have to speak to people like me, because there are alternatives to healing people. And again, as I said, my illness was very bad. All of my teeth had to be replaced. So if I can. me be of any help, I would really like to be.
Okay, well, thank you. I appreciate that.
So I'll just say something. I just want to tell you that our two daughters were part of Amy's study, and I really encourage anybody who's got a sibling and who has an eating disorder to go through Amy, because honestly, when Ned and I went to talk to Amy, like in her office, it really gave us sort of ammunition, if you want to call it, to show other people and to tell other people that no, Amy cannot do this. No, not this Amy, my Amy. You know, the reason why, because the signals are not getting across. And it's fantastic information that Amy can share with you. And I really applaud you, Amy, for all the research that you've done and the way that you are able to explain it. This rocket science of the planet.
My name is Patty Perry, and I'm one of the co-founders of Need. I'm a nurse. I've been in practice for many years, and I'm also a clinical advisor for Need. Amy, your head must be very heavy because you're just an amazing young woman, and you use an awful lot of big words, and yet you then went on to explain and make it really quite simple so that we could really understand what you were saying. So on behalf of the group and me, I'd like to say thank you very, very much for your being a researcher, because I don't always, I know as a clinician I can do that sort of stuff, but you're really providing us with valuable information, both as clinicians and as parents and as families. So thank you very much. I'd also like to say to Lauren, thank you for your very special words about making Temple Sinai available to us. There's so much shame and embarrassment and secrecy about eating disorders. And if we can't come to places like this and share our pain and our sorrow and our losses and our attitudes and our beliefs, then we probably can't share them anyplace. And this is the world has gotten so much more complicated. And so thank you very much for providing this wonderful opportunity for me.
I would add, there is one other thing we have to share, our hopes.
That's right, that's right. And the other, and I think as Amy said, people are recovering all the time. All the time, all the time, all the time. And there's not one way to do it. So the fact that you did it on your own and somebody else did it a different way and somebody else did it a different way, that's the important thing. So recovery is possible.
Just an administrative question. Will these slides be available on the new website?
Yeah, I can move there.
You will, yeah.
Thank you.
Can I just say a few words, practical housekeeping ones? The next symposium, if you're interested, will be in Hamilton in November, and we'll give you details in October. It'll be on the website and in the newsletter. And if anyone has their evaluation forms, can you please fill them in and leave them at the table? That will be very useful. And I don't know if you noticed all the baskets with needles and wool. That is for you to take to your doctor's office. And then we found that the patients sit there and then they start knitting. So that's
can
great.
Can we bring them to the hospital where we're all getting treated?
Yes,
first?
Yes, great.
There's a whole bag of wool and it's in New York.
Please. Thank you all very much.
I'm going to go to the bathroom. I'm going to go to the bathroom.